Only three verses. Are you there? Amen. Okay, let us read. Ready? Read. Now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils, speaking lies in hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with a hot iron, forbidding to marry, and commanding to abstain from meats which God hath created to be received with thanksgiving of them which believe and know the truth. Father, we're so thankful once again for giving us the opportunity to be gathered together to worship you in spirit and in truth. We thank you, O God, for this hour that you've given us so that we can study your word, we can learn, and most importantly, O God, we can apply these principles, doctrines, truths, Lord, in our lives, praying and hoping that it will translate to a better Christian life that we are having, Lord. I pray that you will give me wisdom, because I have none of myself, O God, and the wisdom that I have is not conducive, O God, to spiritual learning, but the wisdom that you will provide is needed so that we will be illuminated as we study your word. I pray, O God, that the Holy Spirit will be the one to speak to us today, so that, O God, we will know the importance of knowing the principles and the doctrines from your word. May you be glorified and give us, Lord, full attention so that we can know, Lord, your will for our lives. We thank you and we will continue to glorify you in our lives. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you very much. So we are going to study about departing from the faith. Departing from the faith, or we can also entitle this as apostasy. So we can see that in the verses that we have read, especially in verse number 1 of 1 Timothy chapter 4, there is a mention that is both through then, through today, and somewhat prophetical, when the Apostle Paul told Timothy, he said that now the Spirit speaketh expressly. Meaning to say, this is something that is known, something that they can hear. Though they cannot hear the actual voice of the Spirit, but through the people that the Holy Spirit is using, the express proclamation of the Holy Spirit is very clear, that Paul says that in the latter times, some shall depart from the faith. So the only good thing here is that the Bible says some shall depart from the faith. Praise God, it is not all. Amen. Meaning to say that there will always be a remnant at any given time who will always stand for the truth and for what is right. And he said that this departing from the faith will be characterized by giving heed to seducing spirits. Meaning to say, the spirit that will allure, or that will lure people to believe or do something that is not according to the word of God. Every temptation is a seduction. Any temptation is an action that is enticing us to do things that are not according to the will of God. And these seducing spirits are the spirits, the evil spirits that the devil have loose into this world in order to make Christians disobey the Lord, or for their minds to be clouded so that we will not know the truth that the Spirit wanted to teach us. So that is why you will see that as time goes by, there are so many different devices that are being invented by the devil in order to lure the people of God into disobeying the Lord, or doing things that are not according to the will of God. That's why if you're going to look at the doctrine of the Word of God and the doctrines that are being propagated since the time of the Apostle Paul until now, it will outnumber the doctrines that are being taught by the Word of God. As I have told you, if you will be observant, you will see that there are so many doctrines about giving that is not sanctioned by the Word of God. There are so many doctrines about the Lord Jesus Christ that is not sanctioned by the Word of God. There is so many doctrines about the church that is not according to the Word of God. Why? Because the devil's work is to confuse people, and when people are confused, they can easily give up their search. Or they can easily give up listening because they will think that all are the same. That is the reason why it is very sad regarding what happened the aftermath of the National Baptist Day, when Inquirer made a news out of it, saying that, of course, President Duterte again cursed during the event. But what is sad is it was emphasized twice on that article that the reaction of the people there, because it's National Baptist Day, therefore the audience are Baptists, that they laugh, and the laughter become louder as the president continue to curse. Well, we already know our president. We cannot stop him from cursing. We cannot control what he's going to say, but we can control how we are going to react or to respond, or to respond to what he said during the event. It should have been a reaction that will make the president uncomfortable, that when he cursed, that nobody will laugh, nobody will clap, nobody will say amen. I don't know if somebody said amen. I doubt it, but nobody will do that. And that people will just be stoic, making him awkward, uncomfortable, so that he will know, this is not the place to curse, because I am standing before people who loves holiness and who loves the Lord. But the sad thing is that it was emphasized that when he lambasted the Catholic Church, then the Baptist reacted in a mocking way. So what if the priest will pick this up, and tomorrow in masses in the Philippines, they will say that the Baptists are mocking us? So our soul winning effort will be affected, because we will not be welcomed anymore by our Catholic friends, whom we love dearly and we want to see their salvation. So these are the things that may happen that we cannot control once we expose ourselves to something that can spiral out of control, because it is really, really something that is not designed by the Lord. They use so many verses in the Bible that are not contextually correct. When the Lord Jesus Christ prayed for unity, he's praying for the unity of the local church, not the whole of Christendom. Because the Lord knew what will happen. He already prophesied that in the latter times, the faith of many shall wax cold. It will become worse. When they say peace, there will be no peace. And it will be like during the time of Noah, before the coming of the Lord. So why will we desire unity when it was already prophesied that it's going to become worse? When it's already prophesied that that some will depart from the faith. How can we be unified if those things are already prophesied by the Lord? So that is why it's very important to understand what is apostasy. It's very important to understand the things that are included or that are leading to what we call apostasy. Because there is in one article that I have read, one study that I have read, there is what we call the spectrum of unbelief and error. A spectrum is going from one extreme to the other extreme. Like yung di ba meron tayong nung sa science yung ano glass, ang tawag doon ay yung pag tumingin kami iba, pag tinamaan ng ilaw, yung lalabas na color iba-iba. spectrum ang tawag doon. So merong iba-ibang colors that from light to darker colors. So the same thing with unbelief, error and apostasy. So we can see that in this spectrum, it included number one, unbelief. Number two, doubt. Number three, ignorance. Number four, error. Number five, heresy. Number six, apostasy. And at the end of the spectrum is reprobation. So this is the natural, what we call growth of unbelief and error that leads not only to apostasy, but it may even lead to what we call reprobation. And we are going to study them today. If the time will permit us, we're going to finish about the spectrum, and then we will go to other topic that has something to do with apostasy. Okay, so the word apostasy belongs to a number of other key doctrinal terms not specifically found in the Bible. You will not find the word apostasy in the Bible. You can find apostate, but you cannot find the word apostasy in the Bible. Like Trinity, you cannot find the word Trinity in the Bible. Rapture, you cannot find that word in the Bible. But even though these words will not be read literally in the Bible, its meaning can be found in the teaching of the Word of God. Like the Trinity, though the word Trinity is not there, but we have a clear teaching that the Father is God, that the Son is God, that the Holy Spirit is God, and these three are one. So that is Trinity. One God in three distinct persons. Like rapture. We may not find the word rapture in the Bible, but we know that in the Bible it is being taught that one day the Lord Jesus will come and He will take away His people from this world. And that is what you call rapture or caught up with the Lord. So apostasy is akin to this, the same as this. Its meaning is in the Bible, though the word cannot be found in the Bible. Why is it important, Pastor, to discuss these things? Because there are people that are disgusting. If they cannot read a particular word, phrase, or sentence in the Bible, they will find a reason not to believe it. Like, for example, is there a phrase in the Bible that says, Jesus is God? Of course, there is none. But the teaching is there. Is there a phrase in the Bible that says, no smoking? Of course, none. But the teaching is there, that we shall not destroy the temple of the Holy Spirit, and our body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. So if smoking will destroy our body, it is destroying the temple, then it is forbidden by God. So there is even a you cannot even find in the Bible that we should not, that there is no, don't drink beer. It's not there. But actually, one very famous what we call things that we put in front of our gate is in the Bible, beware of dogs. Ayun, nakalagay yun dun. Pero yung mga iba hindi nakalagay. But their teaching is in the Bible, as we have said regarding apostasy. Okay, the word apostasy came from the Greek word apostasia. Apostasia, which means a falling in the sense of deflection and rebellion. So it is a falling in the sense of deflection. Deflection is sinasangga mo. And rebellion or going against it. So that is what we call apostasy. The word in is used in Acts chapter 21 verse 21. Can we go there, please? Acts 21:21, and they are informed of thee that thou teachest all the Jews which are among the Gentiles to forsake Moses, saying that they ought not to circumcise their children, neither to walk after the customs. So the word forsake is apostasy. It means to deflect. It means to fall in the sense of rebellion or going against a particular teaching or something that is being taught or mentioned. So that is in Acts 21:21. Therefore, apostasy can be defined as this. It is a deliberate act of repudiation. A deliberate act of repudiation. What is repudiation, Pastor? It means to reject as having no authority. So when we talk about apostasy and we apply it to the Word of God, it means to reject the Word of God because it has no authority according to the apostates. It means to reject as having no authority or binding force. It is not applicable in our time. Therefore, we should not heed the Word of God. It means to cast off or disown. That's why when you are in a state of apostasy, you are disowning the faith that were given to us by the Lord. What Jude says, the faith that was once delivered unto us. It means to abandon. It means to spurn, to reject, or to disavow. That is why during the time of persecution, if a Christian is caught, he will be given a chance to recant or to disavow believing in the Lord. So if they will not, then they're going to be martyred. They're going to be killed. But if they will repudiate their faith, then they will be let go. But they are showing what we call apostasy or turning back or rebelling against the truth. Okay, so let us go at the spectrum leading to apostasy and leading to eventually reprobation. Number one, let us consider unbelief. Unbelief or no faith. Remember that in the things that we're going to study regarding this spectrum of unbelief and error, these things can be applied to unbelievers, and they can also be some can be applied to believers and some can be applied to unbelievers. So what we're going to study is not all for unbelievers and it is not all for unbelievers. It depends on the context so that we will recognize if the Bible is speaking about the unbelievers or the Bible is speaking about the believers. So number one is unbelief or no faith. Let's look at Romans 4:18-21. Romans 4:18-21. Who against hope believe in hope that he might become the father of many nations, according to that which was spoken, so shall thy seed be. And being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body now dead when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. He staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God, and being fully persuaded that what he had promised, he was also able also to perform. Let's go back to verse number 20. So we can see here that unbelief is the opposite of faith. It says, he staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God. So when we say unbelief, it is a person with no faith. He may have faith in other things, but he has no faith in God, and he has no faith in the things of God. So there is an absence of faith when it is applied to unbelievers. You need to understand that. Because later on we will see the other aspect of this. Let us go to Matthew chapter 13, verses 54 to 58. I hope you're taking notes because these are important. And when he was come into his own country, he taught them in their synagogue, insomuch that they were astonished, and said, whence hath this man this wisdom and this mighty works? Is not this the carpenter's son? Is not his mother called Mary, his brethren James and Joseph and Simon and Judas? And his sisters, are they not all with us? Whence then hath this man all these things? And they were offended in him. But Jesus said unto them, a prophet is not without honor, save in his own country and in his own house. And he did not many mighty works there because of their unbelief. So unbelief limits the mighty works of God. You see, God may want to work in the life of an unbeliever. God may want to work in the life of a believer. But when unbelief comes into our hearts, then we are limiting the power of God to do mighty works in us. Listen, whether we believe God or not, He is Almighty. It will not diminish or nor it will add to the power of God. But our attitude of unbelief to the unbelievers will not allow God to work in their lives, and to the lives of the believers, it will limit the power of God to work mightily in our lives because of our unbelief. One example of, is Peter. When he believed God, he was able to walk on top of the water. But when unbelief all of a sudden came into his heart, then he started to sink. Why? Because it limited God to work mightily in him because of that unbelief. Or sometimes we can also call that doubt. So the reason why the Lord Jesus Christ did not many mighty works in the place where he was born is because of their unbelief. And you will be amazed regarding, you know, if people do not want to believe, they can find all excuses. Even though the evidence is glaring and staring them in the face. Look at verse number 54 again. And when he was coming to his own country, he taught them in their synagogue, in so much that they were astonished. Meaning to say, they were amazed at his teaching. Meaning to say that his teaching is something that should be believed, something different, something that is so powerful, and said, whence hath this man this wisdom? It is wise. But because they do not want to believe, they were able to find an excuse not to believe in him. That is why the devil will do everything in order to cloud your heart or your mind, that even though the evidence is overwhelming, you will still choose not to believe. And that is sad. That even though, like, I'm sorry, but I will keep on referring to what happened in the Philippines yesterday, that even though the evidence is very clear in the Bible of separation, but unbelief will make you choose to neglect it. It will make you choose not to believe in what the Bible is teaching, or you're going to make your own interpretation, but that is in another area of the spectrum. Let us go to Acts chapter 16, verse 31. And we will see here that a lost man must believe in order to be saved. If there is no belief, of course, implied repentance, then there is not going to be salvation. According to Acts 16, verse number 31. And they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved and thy house. So, if there is unbelief in the heart of the unbelievers, they will not be saved until and unless they believe. And that is the opposite of unbelief. Then that's the only time that they are going to be saved. So we can see that unbelief is fatal. If you die in your unbelief as an unbeliever, then you will go to hell, and there is no chance. In John chapter 8, verse number 24, this is what will happen. I said therefore unto you that ye shall die in your sins. For if ye believe not that I am he, ye shall die in your sins. So it will cause you to die in your sins. And if you will die in your sins, then what will happen is Revelation 21:8. Revelation 21:8. But the fearful and unbelieving, and the abominable and murderers and whoremongers and sorcerers and adulterers and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. So if you die in your unbelief, then your final destination will be the lake of fire. And then in Mark chapter 16, verse number 14, we can see here that it is possible for a Christian to have unbelief in their heart. That's why I'm telling you, you look at the context, if the context is talking about the unbelievers or the context is talking about the believers. Because when the context is talking about the unbelievers, it will cause them to go to hell, but it will not happen to the believers. But it is possible for the believers to have unbelief in their hearts. Afterward, he appeared unto the 11 as they sat at meat and upbraided them with their unbelief. So they were rebuked by the Lord because of their unbelief. Not unbelief that Jesus is the Savior, but they do not believe that Jesus rose from the dead. So that is why they were rebuked. They were upbraided by the Lord, them with their unbelief and hardness of heart, because they believed not them which had seen him after he was risen. So there was already a report, and they said, unless we see him, we will not believe. So that is unbelief. But it is not an unbelief that will send us to hell, but it is an unbelief that will not allow us to have the fullness of joy as we are living the Christian life. Why? Because God says that everything is possible to him that believe. Meaning to say, we can live the Christian life, and we can live it to a maximum if we are going to have faith remain in our hearts. Another instance is in Hebrews chapter 3, verses 12 to 13. Take heed, brethren. So the author is talking to those that are in the family of God. He said, take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. So you can turn your back on the Lord, even though you are a brethren in God. Look at verse number 13. But exhort one another daily, while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. There is a possibility that a Christian may have unbelief and then continue in that state, and his heart will become hardened because of the deceitfulness of sin. That is why, if you're going to observe, why is it that so many people, even people that are standing behind the behind the pulpit, will continue doing those things that are wrong, teaching those things that are wrong, in spite the evidence from the Word of God that those things were not so? That is because their heart is beginning to become harder and harder as they continue practicing something that is not according to the Word of God, or sin, because sin is something that is deceitful. Amen. So that's why whenever we post something against politician, a pastor, politician, and all of these things, some will always answer, why don't you go to them and talk to them? They will not believe us because they were already deceived by sin. So, pastor, are they saved? Of course, they're brethren. These are brethren. The author of Hebrews is talking to his brothers and sisters in the Lord. And let's go back to verse 12, please. And what he said is very clear. Take heed. Mag-ingat kayo, mga kapatid. Diba? Mga kapatid. Lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. So even though we're saved, we can still have an evil heart of unbelief. How can that happen? Later on, we will see. How is it possible for a Christian to instill love and belief in their hearts. And we will see that later on, why these things are happening. But also here in verse 13, we were taught on how to avoid unbelief. And that is by exhorting one another. That is why our fellowship, our study, everything that we do in the church is very pivotal and important, so that we are not going to develop a heart of unbelief. Amen? That's why we exhort one another. We encourage one another. We sometimes rebuke one another, so that we will stay in the truth of the Word of God. Look at Psalms 119, 10 to 12. With my whole heart have I sought thee. O let me not wander from thy commandments. Thy word have I hid in mine heart, that I might not sin against thee. Blessed art thou, O Lord. Teach me thy statutes. Let us go back to verse 11. And let us try to analyze this even in a short time. The Bible says, thy word have I hid in mine heart, that I might not sin against thee. So meaning to say, if we are not going to hide or read or understand or meditate upon the word of God, then we will commit sin. And if we will continue to neglect the word of God, then we will continue to commit sin until the time that our heart will become hardened by sin. And God has to step in, chastise us, or take us out of this world in order to bring us to our own spiritual senses. That's why there is a sin unto death among the people of God. So that's something that we need to understand. In Mark chapter 9 verse 24, this should be the cry of our hearts. And straightway the father of the child cried out and said with tears, Lord, I believe. And he said, help thou mine unbelief. So you are believing and not believing at the same time. You see that? Lord, I believe. Help thou mine unbelief. So this can happen to an unbeliever, and it will cause an unbeliever to go to hell. And this can happen to a Christian, and this will cause a Christian to lose his joy in his Christian life. So that is why it is very important to understand that this can happen to both believers and unbelievers. So unbelief is the first form of departure from faith. It means no faith. Number two is doubt. Doubt or little faith. Doubt or little faith. Matthew chapter 14 verse number 25. Ito yun yung nangyari kay Peter. And in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went unto them walking on the sea. Sige, tuloy natin hanggang 31. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, it is a spirit. And they cried out of fear. So itong mga disciples, apostles, matatakotin ito sa multo. Kaya kung matatakotin kayo sa multo, hindi kayo nag-iisa. But straightway, Jesus spake unto them, saying, be of good cheer. It is I. Be not afraid. But we're exhorted by God not to be afraid. Amen? Not only that, because it was the Lord Jesus Christ, but because we are already saved, we have the Holy Spirit, and there is no spirit that can overcome the spirit that is in us. Actually, the Bible says, greater is he that is in you, that's the Holy Spirit, than he that is in the world. So kung yung mga nanonood ng eerie, huwag kayong matakot. Amen? Dalawa lang yung eerie na yan eh. Either matatakot ka o mababahuan ka. Depende kung saan ka nag-i-eerie. And verse 29, and he said, come. And when Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. You see, the only other person who was able to walk on the water is the Apostle Peter. But when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried, saying, Lord, save me. And immediately Jesus stretched forth his hand and caught him and said unto him, O thou of little faith, wherefore didst thou doubt? You see, doubt means little faith. It may be a hint of unbelief, it may be the precursor to unbelief, but it means that you have little faith, or if you already have a strong faith, then it means that your faith is waning, or it is fading. So that's why he said, why didst thou doubt? Jesus said Peter had little faith in verse number 31. Even though he obeyed the Lord, you can still have a waning faith. Obeying God should increase our faith. But when we let our eyes out of focus, then it can decrease our faith in the Lord. Why? Look at verse number 30. Being afraid caused Peter to take his eyes off the Lord. You see, if we are in the Lord, God has not given us the spirit of fear. That's why we should not be afraid. If you are afraid to go out in a limb, like for example in a mission field, because of the so many negative things that you will hear, then you will not be able to make it. You're not going to go there. You're not going to serve the Lord, missing the opportunity to do something great for God and for our fellow men. So fear will cause us to take our eyes off the Lord Jesus Christ. Luke chapter 12, verses 22 to 31. And he said unto his disciples, therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life what ye shall eat, neither for the body what ye shall put on. The life is more than meat, and the body is more than raiment. Consider the ravens, for they neither sow nor reap, which neither have storehouse nor barn, and God feedeth them. How much more are ye better than the fowls? And which of you, with taking thought, can add to his stature one cubit? So, worry is unavailing. Kasi, sino raw sa inyo yung nag-alala na tumangkad? Ay, ang late ko naman. Ay, maliit ka talaga. Kahit mag-alala ka pa, hindi ka tatangkad, hindi madadagdagan yung height mo. If ye then be not able to do that thing which is least, why take ye thought for the rest? Consider the lilies, and there was a lily. Consider a lily. How they grow. They toil not, they spin not. And yet I say unto you, that Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of this. If then God so clothed the grass, which is today in the field, and tomorrow is cast into the oven, how much more will he clothe ye, O ye of little faith? Tuloy kapatid, hanggang 31 tayo. And seek not ye what ye shall eat, or what ye shall drink, neither be ye of doubtful mind. For all these things do the nations of the world seek after, and your Father knoweth that ye have need of these things. But rather seek ye the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you. So, God is exhorting them not to doubt, not to have a weak faith or little faith, but to seek first the kingdom of God. By doing so, everything will be added unto us by God. Amen. So the focus of every Christian should be the kingdom of God, not our concerns, not our worries, because God already knows them. And if God is a faithful God, then He has a way of supplying them. So we need not worry. But when we put these things first in our mind, then all our action will be towards achieving these things, and there will be no satisfaction in our lives. But if we will serve God, we will see that the blessing of God will flow through us, or even to us by the grace of God. So don't allow doubt, and don't allow little faith to enter our hearts that will affect our service in the Lord. And then we will go to Romans chapter 14. It has something to do with dietary laws and customs and holidays and whether Christians are obligated to observe them. The answer, of course, is no. We are no longer under the law. Amen. And when you allow yourself to become under the law, it will make you weak in your faith. Let us just look at the first few verses of Romans chapter 14. Him that is weak in the faith, see? Receive ye, but not to doubtful disputations. Why are they weak in the faith? For one believeth that he may eat all things, another who is weak eateth herbs. Why? Because they still have the mentality of being under the law. And because of that mentality, it is actually stunting their growth in God. Hindi sila lumalaki. Hindi sila nag-grow. Kasi pinipigil sila ng mentality na sila ay still under the law. But the Bible says, let not him that eateth despise him that eateth not, and let not him which eateth not judge him that eateth, for God hath received him. So if you are more spiritual than them, then it is our responsibility to guide them into spiritual maturity. Hindi pagtawanan. Ay, hindi nakain ng dinugan. Kito, mayroon ng puto. Ang sarap ko, kamang ganun. So, hindi dapat ginaganon. Kung doon pa yung kanilang ano paniniwala, so wag nating aasarin. Let us guide them so that they will grow in the Lord. Amen. So, it means that this does not give Christian the right to disregard those who struggle in different areas of their Christian life. Because whether you like it or not, I have an area of weakness. You have an area of weakness. And we should not mock those people in the area of their weakness. But let us pray for them. Let us encourage them so that they will be able to make full proof of our ministry in the Lord. Kasi ang diablo, tuso yan eh. Hindi ka naman titirayin ng diablo kung saan ka malakas eh. Aksaya ng panahon yun. Titirayin ka ng diablo kung saan ka mahina. Dahil pag tumama yun, siguradong masasaktan tayo. That is the reason why if we will still mock one another, then we are weakening further the weakness of our brothers and sisters in the Lord. But if we will exhort, encourage, pray for one another, and teach one another, then we are strengthening the weak area so that when the devil attacks, then we have a more formidable defense than before. So it behooves us that our faith will increase by the grace of God. Amen? Number three is ignorance. Number one is what? Unbelief. What is unbelief? No faith, not believing in the Lord. Number two is doubt. What is doubt? Yeah, little faith. And what causes doubt? Because of fear and the worries of this world. And those things will diminish our faith. And our faith will also be diminished when our own beliefs cause us to be weak in faith. Because sometimes we insist on what we believe. When the Bible is very clear, lean not unto thine own understanding. So, in all thy ways, acknowledge God. Let God be God. Let's believe the word of God. Thus saith the Lord. That's our final authority. Don't insist on what you believe. That's why Pastor Jesse Sang even questioned the preaching of unity, that they said that we can work together. That is not the design of God. Even during the time of the Lord Jesus Christ, while the Lord Jesus Christ was ministering, one of the disciples came and he said, there is one there that is teaching and baptizing in your name. So it says that if they are not against us, they are with us or for us. But what we need to notice is even during the time of the Lord Jesus Christ, there are already splinters of ministries that are going on. And Jesus did not even try to unite all of them. Why? Because that is not his design. The Lord Jesus Christ's wisdom in building the local church and local church only
is something to behold. Because if he will make a universal church or a centralized church, if you destroy the head, then everything will be destroyed. But our head is the Lord Jesus Christ. He cannot be destroyed. Therefore, no matter what happens, the local churches will continue. You may destroy IBCSR, you may destroy other churches, but there are still remnants that will continue to preach the Word of God. And that is the wisdom of God. So when you rely on your own wisdom, he said, let us gather together, let us be as one so that we can become stronger, then we are going to be weak. Why? Our strength is only in the joy of the Lord, not our own strength. So, imbis na lumakas, lalo tayong humihina. May mga backlash na, tulad ng sinabi ko. Maraming kaaway ang presidente. Ang Inquirer, minumura niya ng Inquirer. Galit ang Inquirer. Nakachempo ang Inquirer na pwede niyang isulat. Isinulat ng Inquirer. Binanatan siya. Dahil in-invite natin siya. Dadamay tayo. Ngayon, Pastor, wala naman ako ron. Pero Baptist ka. Yan ang masakit noon. Kasama tayo ron. Dahil Baptist tayo. So pagka lumapit ka, ano kayo? Baptist? Ay, hindi. Pinagtatawanan nyo kami. Paano pang manikikinig sa atin yan? Diba? So that's why we have to be careful on people that we are associated with. You see, for you to understand, I do not doubt the motive of Dr. Quezon regarding IBMA joining the National Baptist Day. The truth of the matter, as I told you before, he called me and explained to me his reason behind joining. But I told him, Pastor, I will pray for wisdom for you and our leaders in IBMA. But I will continue to be the devil's advocate. I will analyze, I will warn, I will post, and all of these things, so that there is a check and balance. But I'm not going to say anything against IBMA regarding this, because I know the reason why. I know the desire. Dr. Quezon has no desire for limelight. Because in so many years, he could have done that. Mind you, brothers and sisters in the Lord, to God be the glory. The strongest group among all the Baptists in the Philippines right now is IBMA. Perhaps no single group can have or planted churches more than what IBMA accomplished. But actually, we do not care about that. We just serve the Lord. But Dr. Quezon saw this as an opportunity to challenge those who will attend to plant churches instead of doing so many other things. And that is his agenda or his motive in going there. But I told them, yes, I do not doubt our motive, but we already know the motive of the organizer. Because I even wrote Pastor Miles and I told him that the organizer or the one who spearheaded this National Baptist Day already compromised during campaign time before the election. And I mentioned the three things that we have seen on Facebook. Number one, lighting of the grotto. Number two, giving money for the printing of the Black Nazarene. And number three, sponsoring a Valentine's concert. I mentioned that. So I said that your motives are good. But there is one person whose motive is wrong and selfish. And it is so sad to see that our good motive is being used by a person whose only desire is to push his political agenda. And now, it backfired in some areas. Even some are being personally affected, and they are now worrying what may happen. So that is why we have to be careful, and we need to learn our lesson. Don't allow unbelievers to stand and speak in front of the believers, because that is actually going against what Psalm says, that we should not sit on the counsel of the ungodly. That is very, very clear from the Word of God. But anyway, let's proceed. Number three is ignorance. Ignorance. It can be a precursor to a growing faith. Because ignorance will not allow you to have faith, but once enlightenment comes in, then it will allow you to have faith and to continue growing your faith in the Lord. But some may not be able to even approach this growth in faith, because ignorance may even stop them from having faith or to have their faith grow in the Lord. Okay, the word ignorant means uninformed. Uninformed or unlearned. Uninformed or unlearned, or one lacking in knowledge. Lacking in knowledge. Look at Ephesians 4:17 to 18. This I say therefore and testify in the Lord, that ye henceforth walk not as other Gentiles walk, in the vanity of their mind, having the understanding darkened, being alienated from the life of God through the ignorance that is in them, because of the blindness of their heart. So we can see that the Apostle Paul in this passage mentioned that the Jews are ignorant of the Word of God. Listen, they may know the Word of God, but they are ignorant of the meaning of the Word of God. Like, for example, Sabbath. They know Sabbath, but they do not know the meaning of Sabbath. Why? Because they even try to stop the Lord or judge the Lord from disobeying the Sabbath when he helped somebody during the Sabbath day. And during that exchange of explanation, the Lord Jesus Christ told them that he is the Lord of the Sabbath. He is the one who created the Sabbath. And he said, I created the Sabbath for people and not people for the Sabbath. So, even though they may know the Word of God, but they can still be ignorant, unlearned, or uninformed regarding the Word of God. Let us look at Acts chapter 3, verse 17. Acts chapter 3, let's start from verse number 12, please. Let's go to 12 first. And when Peter saw it, he answered unto the people, ye men of Israel, why marvel ye at this? Or why look ye so earnestly on us, as though by our own power or holiness we had made this man to walk? The God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob, the God of our fathers, had glorified his son Jesus, whom ye delivered up and denied him in the presence of Pilate when he was determined to let him go. But ye denied the Holy One and the just, and desired a murderer to be granted unto you, and killed the Prince of Life, whom God hath raised from the dead, whereof we are witnesses. And his name, through faith in his name, hath made this man strong, whom ye see and know. Yea, the faith which is by him hath given him this perfect soundness in the presence of you all. And now, brethren, I wot that through ignorance ye did it, as did also your rulers. But those things which God before had showed by the mouth of all his prophets that Christ should suffer, he had so fulfilled. Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. And he shall send Jesus Christ, which before was preached unto you,
whom the heaven must receive until the times of restitution of all things which God hath spoken by the mouth of all his holy prophets since the world began. So you see, when they perform a miracle, the people were astonished. They were, it is as if something strange happened. But then, again, let's go back to verse number 12. Look at what Peter said when they healed the man lame at the temple. And when Peter saw it, he answered unto the people, "Ye men of Israel, why marvel ye at this?" Ba't nagtataka kayo? It was in the Bible. It was written all over in the Old Testament that God is a God of miracles. That God is a mighty God. That God is almighty. That He created the heavens and the earth. He created the universe. Everything is possible with God. And yet, He is telling them, "Why are ye marveling at this? Or why look ye so earnestly on us as though by our own power or holiness we had made this man to walk?" It is not us. It is the work of God. And he said that is in verse 17, he summarizes it and he said, "And now, brethren, I wot that through ignorance ye did it, as did also your rulers." Why? Because you do not know the word of God. You may know the word of God, but you are uninformed. But you are unlearned. But you are lacking in knowledge of the word of God. So we can see that the Jews are ignorant of the word of God. They should be the ones who should know the word of God, because the oracles of God were committed to them so that they will be the light of the word, but they are ignorant of God's word. They are living in darkness. So we can see that ignorance will not allow you to have faith, or if you are a Christian, it will not allow you to have a growing faith because of ignorance. And then look at not only the Jews, but look at Romans 11:25. "For I would not, brethren, that ye should be ignorant of this mystery, lest you should be wise in your own conceits, that blindness in part is happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles be come in." So if the Jews are ignorant of the word of God, even the Gentiles are ignorant of the word of God. Even the converted Gentiles are still ignorant of the word of God. And that is the reason why they are not yet growing. Why? Because ignorance is indicative of youth. I'm not saying that if you are young, you're ignorant. But when you are young, there is more ignorance in you than information or learning. Because as you grow in age, as you age, then you learn more and more, and your ignorance is waning and your knowledge is growing. That is the reason why when the word of God is being preached, it causes us to grow our faith, because our ignorance is waning. It's fading. It is being replaced by knowledge. But if we will not know the word of God, then we will continue in our ignorance and we will become babes in the Lord. Look at 1 Peter chapter 2, verse number 2. Let us, verse 1 first. 2 Peter, I'm sorry. 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 1 to 3. "Wherefore, laying aside all malice and all guile and hypocrisies and envies and all evil speaking, as newborn babes desire the sincere milk of the word, that ye may grow thereby. If so be ye have tasted that the Lord is gracious." So you desire the word of God and you will grow because of the graciousness of God. But if you will not desire the word of God, what will happen? Look at verse number 1. Let's go back to verse number 1. Your life will be filled with malice and guile and hypocrisies and envies and evil speakings. That is why, even though in the church of God, supposedly composed of Christians, there are malicious people. There are people with guile. There are
hypocrites, and there are those that envy other Christians, and there are people that speak evil one of another. Why? Because we are ignorant of the Word of God. We are unlearned from the Word of God. But in verse number 2, we will desire the sincere milk of the Word of God. Because you are, babe, you need to grow. Amen? And when we desire the sincere milk of the Word of God, we will grow. And when we grow, then we are going to become matured. And what will happen? Evil speakings will be removed. Envying, guile, and all of these things will be removed out of our hearts or out of our life. That is why it is very important for us to grow in the Lord. Amen? Look at 2 Peter chapter 3, verse number 18. But grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever. Amen. So our growth must be in grace through the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. The more we know Him, the more we grow in grace. The more we know Him, the more we will become matured. The more we know Jesus, the more we will depend on Him. That is the natural progression of this. Look at verse 19. Oh, wala na yata. Hanggang 18 lang yan. Sabi ko sa inyo eh. Yun, pag may 19, sumobra na yung growth. Hindi na maganda yun. Amen. Lahat ng sobra, hindi maganda. No, 17 muna. Pala. Nabasa natin 17 na. Yun pala yung ibig sabihin. Ye therefore, beloved, seeing ye know these things before, beware, lest ye also being led away with the error of the wicked, fall from your own steadfastness. Then he said, grow in grace. Listen. Christians must be patient with each other. Why? Because some Christians' growth is very slow. And we do not have to rush them. They need to grow at their own pace, or at the pace that God wants them to grow. There is this saying, God knows our need and He will give it, but not in our own speed. That's something that we need to understand. Because we are an impatient people. We want it now. Right here, right now. But there is a proper timing with God. So, there are people, there are Christians who may be slow in growth, but what is important is that even though slowly, but surely. So, we have to be patient with some people. Don't tell them that you've been a Christian for 1 year until now you're not serving God full-time in the ministry. With 1 year, for some, it's just a short time. Let's give them more time. What's important is that there is a semblance of growth and life in this people. And as we grow, then ignorance is going to be taken away from us, and it will be replaced with a growing faith by the grace of God. So, ignorance is applied to all people if they are not going to really diligently study the Word of God. So, let us go on the darker side of this spectrum. Number 4, error or false faith. Error or false faith. Let us look at Matthew 22:29-30. Matthew 22:29-30. Jesus answered and said unto them, ye do err, not knowing the scriptures nor the power of God. For in the resurrection they neither marry nor are given in marriage, but are as the angels of God in heaven. So we can see here that error can come because we do not know the scriptures. That's why if you will not read the Word of God, you are going to be susceptible to error. If you will not study the Word of God, you will be a sucker for what we call the erroneous teaching of the devil. That's why people most of the time hold on to sayings than to the word of God. Like for example, is it not good to see Baptists in unity? You will say, well, it's good. Because the Bible says, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It's good. It is pleasant. But question, is it biblical unity? That is what we need to understand. Not all unity is glorifying to God. False prophets can unite. Actually, the Sadducees and the Pharisees unite in order to destroy Jesus Christ. So not all unity is pleasing to God. A unity in error is not a biblical unity. What's important is unity in the fundamentals, but independent in our own ministries. Amen? That is the design of God. That we believe the fundamentals, all of us are united in that, but we remain our autonomy as we are autonomously established by the Lord. So that's why, if you do not know the word of God, you can easily be led astray from the truth by what we call good speakers that may not be teaching or that are not actually teaching the word of God. And even an erroneous teaching will be believed by those people who do not really study the word of God. Like first fruits. Ayan. Non-transfer of membership. Ayan. National Baptist Day. Ayan. Yung tinatawag natin na what do you call this? No repentance. Ayan. Ano ka? Madadala ka. Kasi nga naman, sabi nila, oh look at John 3:16, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, so that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. Where is repentance there? Acts 16:31, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved and thine house. Where is repentance there? You see? And because you do not study the word of God, you will believe them. But if you know the word of God, you can tell them and you can quote verses that repentance is a part and parcel of faith. That without repentance, there can be no real faith. And without faith, there can be no real repentance. Because these two are inseparable. They always go together. Look at Acts chapter 20 and 21. Testifying both to the Jews and also to the Greeks, repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. That's clear. You see, one verse may teach something, and other verse may complete the teaching of a verse. That's why the Bible says, comparing scriptures with scriptures, so that we will understand. Like for example, you talk to a Pentecostal and they will say, you can lose your salvation. Then you will say, why and how? You see, do you believe that our salvation is a gift from God? Then you will say, yes. It is the gift of God given to us when we receive the Lord Jesus Christ. So what if I do not want that gift anymore? And I threw it. Do I still have the gift? No, you don't. So therefore, I lost my salvation when I threw the gift away. So how can you contradict that? How can you refute that? You compare scripture with scripture. Yes, salvation is a gift, because in this area, the Lord is talking about the freeness of salvation, that you do not have to pay for your salvation. But that is only one aspect of the broad spectrum of salvation. But how about this? Salvation is also regeneration, born again. Question, how can you be unborn? Balik mo sa kanya. And salvation is also justification. There is no such thing as double jeopardy. If God justified you, then no man can condemn you. Salvation is also sanctification. Salvation is also glorification. Salvation is also imputation. Salvation is also sapatos nisyon. Diba? So salvation is broad, but when you put them together and when you see the completeness of salvation, there will be no doubt in your mind that you are eternally secured. Because salvation as a gift is only one aspect of salvation, one area of emphasis when it comes to salvation. And the wholeness of salvation is the complete work of the Lord Jesus Christ. If our salvation is based on the work of the Lord Jesus Christ, what can undo the work of Jesus? Nothing. Can my sin undo his work? No. His work is final. That's why he says, it is finished. And there is nothing that anybody can do about it. Because it is a complete work of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why we have to be careful in studying the Word of God. Because if we will not really study the Word of God, we might be in error. And error can come because we do not know the Scriptures. Let us look at 1 Timothy chapter 6, 9 to 11. Anong oras na ba? Wala akong grilo. 11:40. So meron pa tayong 1 hour and 20 minutes. 1 Timothy 6, 9 to 11. But they that will be rich fall into temptation and a snare, and to many foolish and hurtful lusts, which drown men in destruction and perdition. For the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some coveted after, they have erred from the faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. But thou, O man of God, flee these things and follow after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, meekness. What can we see in verse number 10? We can see there that covetousness causes us to have false faith. You see? Love of money. Covetousness will cause you to err from the faith. Why? Because you are going to invent a teaching that is not according to the Word of God to satisfy your covetousness. Amen. So you will now err from the faith. Or you will apply those things that are only applicable to the Jews and apply them to the church so that you can get money from them because you love money more than God, then you will err from the faith. That is why I told you before, so many invented doctrines are about giving. Yun ang pinakamarami na inventong doktrina pagdating sa giving. Because of covetousness. Because of love of money. Pinakamaraming na inventong doktrina pagdating sa giving, si Abante tsaka si Sauco. Pinakamarami. Pastor's care. Pastor's car. Pastor's insurance. Pastor's groceries. Pastor's Sunday. Ano pa? First fruits. Patriarch's Night. Ano pa? Whatever doctrine. Ang dami. White Christmas. Ano pa? Magkakaroon na ng Rainbow Christmas niyan. Lalo na pag marami ng LGBT sa loob ng ano, ng church. Ang daming doktrinang naimbento. Yung first fruits ginawa pang hulugan. Ang dami. Ako, isa lang ang naimbento ko, hindi naman sumikat, praise the Lord, tribulation giving. Kasi pangalan pa lang ayaw na. So why? Because of the love of money. That's why they are erring from the faith. They are becoming false teachers with regards to this area. Hindi sila false teacher per se. Huwag niyo akong pagkamalan. Pastor, hindi ba mga sabi mga, I will not even question their salvation. I'm not going to do that. Pero there are areas that they are clearly teaching false doctrine. Especially as I have said, when it comes to giving. Meron nga isa yung pastor sa Pasay. Meron doon nag-alok sa kanya na ano, magpastor sa ibang church. Ang sabi niya raw, hindi niyo siguro kaya ang fee ko. Magkano raw ang ano niya? 7 million? Hindi niyo kaya ang bayad ko. Kaya nga maliwanag na hireling. Kasi nagpapabayad. Merong fee, talent fee. Mahirap nga naman mag-preach minsan, mahirap nga naman mag-inspirational talk. Eh merong, it takes talent. So yung talent, kailangan na bayaran. So, that's why covetousness causes us to have false faith. It causes us to believe what we want or wish to believe in order to satisfy our own greed. Number three. Let us look at 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 20 to 21. O Timothy, keep that which is committed to thy trust, avoiding profane and vain babblings and oppositions of science falsely so called, which some professing have erred concerning the faith. Grace be with thee. Amen. Even science that is according to the word of God will cause us to err from the faith. Yung tinatawag natin na flat earth theory that is opposing the word of God. Yung global warming that is opposing the word of God. Yung mga science na hindi evolution that is in direct opposition from the word of God, believing that we came from your relatives and then we ended up like this, that they said billions of years ago there is a molecule that is moving in the universe, and after so many millions of years all of a sudden it grew, and after so many millions of years it found itself on earth, and after so many millions of years it grew like a frog, and after so many millions of years it decided to jump out of the water, and it grew a hair and tail, and after so many millions of years the hair all of a sudden fall out, and the tails fall out, and then after so many years Brother Haji is there. That's evolution. That's against the word of God. Amen? Why? The Bible is clear. We are created in the image and the likeness of God. So that is what we need to believe. And we should not believe science that is in opposition to the word of God. And then 2 Peter chapter 3, 16 to 17. As also in all his epistles, speaking in them of these things, in which are some things hard to be understood, which they that are unlearned and unstable rest, as they do also these other scriptures, unto their own destruction. Ye therefore, beloved, seeing ye know these things before, beware, lest also, being led away with the error of the wicked, fall from your own steadfastness. We can see here that Christians can be led astray by error of those that rest with the scripture. You see, some things in the Bible are hard to understand. Not all. Not many. But some. And because some things are hard to be understood, there are people who try to interpret them privately. And try to make them agree with what they believe, therefore it will lead to their own destruction and the people that will believe them. That is why Do not answer a question when you really do not know the answer. Do not invent an answer just to make people believe that you know much from the Word of God, or to lift up your ego. No, if you do not know the answer, be honest. Give me time. I'm going to study about this because I'm not really sure how to answer your question. But because you are unlearned, you are unstable, and you want to give a sense of stability to those that are asking you the question, then you will answer them even though you do not know the truth or the fact from the Word of God. So this thing can make us teach erroneous doctrine. Like as I have said, I have a professor before in Bible school who developed a doctrine of dark pavilion, that during the rapture only the spiritual Christians will be raptured, but the backsliders will not be raptured. Instead, they will be a place in what you call pavilion, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. He said this is not hell, because in hell there is fire, but this pavilion is complete darkness, and they are going to weep. Why? Because they have squandered their chance to serve the Lord, and they will gnash their teeth because they are regretting and repenting of that particular chance. So they will stay there for 7 years, and then after that they will be released, and they will join those Christians that are faithful. Therefore, these Christians that are in the pavilion will have no reward, because the reward will coincide with the 7 years of tribulation. So while we are rejoicing, he said, if you are spiritual, these are weeping and gnashing their teeth. That's why he said, you, sabi niya sa mga members, who are not faithful in attendance, you, who are not faithful in giving, you, who are not obeying your pastor, you, that are not faithful in the Lord, you remember this, when the rapture comes, you will not be with Jesus. And you have to be careful. That's why you repent now and be faithful, so that at the rapture, you will be caught by the Lord Jesus Christ and not be thrown into outer darkness where there is weeping and gnashing of teeth. And actually, later on, in some conversation, he was able to really say the reason behind, and he said that I'm trying to instill fear in the hearts of the members so that they will become faithful in the Lord. So you don't have to invent doctrine. You just teach the Word of God and let the Holy Spirit do His work in the heart of people. Amen? Because sometimes we want to do the work of the Holy Spirit, especially during the invitation. When the pastor gives the invitation and almost nobody are in front of the altar, the pastor will now try to do the work of the Holy Spirit. See? Ding. Do not let your heart be hardened. God has spoken to each and every one of us. Do not remain there. You need to go forward and repent and cry out to God. Come on. Come on. Come on. Two more stanzas, my brother. Until the time that you will tell yourself, let us just go forward so that this ordeal will end. And then that's the only time that the service will end. You see, there's always that temptation to do the work of the Holy Spirit. Let the Holy Spirit do His work. Amen? Amen. Our job is to preach, to warn people, and that's it. After that, the Holy Spirit will take over. So this is what we call error or false faith. And this is the fourth in the spectrum of unbelief and error. And the number five is heresy. But we will pick up on this tomorrow. we cannot finish all of this today. So we will continue this tomorrow. We will still discuss about heresy, and then apostasy, and then reprobation. So we will finish the spectrum, and then after that, if time will permit, we will go to four ways that apostasy can creep into the church, so that we can plug them and not allow the devil to have an inroad in order to penetrate our church and cause apostasy or even reprobation in the people in the church. Or he may plant tare that is a heretic and an apostate and will entice people to become reprobate in the Lord. So we're going to study that tomorrow. Shall we stand up and let us pray? Father, we're so thankful for the time that you have given us.